I will present the initial results and...
They're not hearing me? Because I need to...
I will try. initial results and insight that we have. We have on a project that we are conducting, aim to republish the archaeological material from two upper paleolithic sites in the Judean desert, El Kusser and Mazra Kenaj. Archaeological material that was originally published in 55 by Jean Perrot. The introduction to our story is beginning with René Neville, the French diplomat and archaeologist that we heard. That we heard of his doing from Jan, which was involved in several archaeological projects in the southern Levant, which had a fundamental impact on the prehistoric research of this region. So a little bit of his contributions. First, the chronological framework of the prehistoric periods in the Levant, as mentioned before, we will see it shortly. The definition of upper paleolithic chronocultural sequence within this chronological framework, the definition of the Rasulian culture in the Chalcolithic periods, excavation in the Judean desert, such as Umm Katafa, El Khiam, and also Erkel Ahmar, which those sites are the base site, as long as the site that Dorothy Gerrod excavated, such as El Wad and Shukba, the base sites for the chronological framework that he suggested, and eventually a bit of the Kafze story. He also was involved in this excavation. So this is the chronological framework that he suggested already in 34, as Jan mentioned. We can see that basically the guidelines are still used by us today, but interestingly, the Middle Paleolithic is virtually non-existent when the Mousterian culture is on the end of the Lower Paleolithic, but this is another story. We will deal with the Upper Paleolithic, Paleolithic Superior, a period of time that today is dated to around 50,000 before present, just until 23 before present. And sorry, I forgot to mention that some of the site that was excavated in the Judean desert, such as Umm Katafa, Erkel Ahmar, and El Khiam, just here, is used for this chronological framework. So this is the publication of the 1951 that is the final publication of the Wild Project in the Judean Desert of René Neville, which was focused on two mainstream, Nachal Charitum, which also known as Nachal Tkoa, and Nachal Arugot. Several cave sites such as this were excavated, and the final publication is on 1951, after he's coming back from the war and all of this story, and the fact that he has to stop his research in 1937, that he had to leave Palestine due to the conflict in Europe. Also, we can see from the, as Jan mentioned, that this research is basically interdisciplinary research, which involves also geology and archaeology, and made by a French Israelo team, basically, as we see, Bentor is also here, and Perrot, and Bouffray, that we heard not the very nice things about just now. But another thing that we need to appreciate is that the fieldwork, the actual fieldwork, was made by locals, Arab, that most probably pretty soon became like trained archaeologists, and those are the ones who did the work. So now our story begins. We are in the early 50s. The large publication of Neville already is done. He is after all these years of conflict and war. And our story begins. In the early 50s, the shift of excavation of Neville from the project in the Judean desert is bringing him material, archaeological material from two sites that he excavated by himself in the Judean desert, El Kusser and Mazar Kenash. In that stage, Neville is already ill. He understands that he won't be able to process the material, so he's passing the material to his friend and colleague, Jean Perrot, that a lot of you know about his story, and he's taking it upon himself to publish the story. What we need to appreciate is that most probably, for sure, Neville is already ill. He never visited the site, and also Perrot never visited the site. Attest to that, we can see in the publication that we don't have plans of the site and stuff like that. So we need to ask ourselves, why those sites are marked in those two places? Most probably because the Ta'amraman, the chief of excavation, this is what he told Perrot, Neville, or both, when they started working on the material. So the Perrot conclusion from 1955 are as follows. In El Kusser, the excavator was identifying five stratigraphic layers without reaching bedrock. Two of those layers contained archaeological material. After the typological analysis that Perrot did to those materials, he attributed layer C to the Aurignacian culture and layer D to Paleolithic Superior phase 4 or 5 in Neville Shim. Layer D later was attributed to the Akhmarian culture, which was defined by Gilad in 81, after a site of Neville, Erkel Achmar, from the Judean desert. In Mazar Kenash, the situation is a bit different. Only four stratigraphic layers were identified by the excavator, again without reaching bedrock. And in that case, the bottom layer was the one with the archaeological material. After the typological analysis, Perrot cautiously defined it as the Paleolithic Superior phase 3 or 4. I say cautiously because even in one of his tables that he is showing, the material is putting question mark next to it. This material of Mazar Kenash, later on and after other research in the Negev and Northern Sinai, which made by Nigel Goring Morris, was identified as a type site of the, and type assemblage actually, to the Mazrakan culture industry, which is situated at the final stages of the Upper Paleolithic. So these are three, here maybe we can see the question mark, no, it's very, very vague. But here there is the question mark about the cultural affiliation of this assemblage. Three assemblages, layer C, where scrapers are a very marked feature. Carinated scraper, which fits the affiliation to the Aurignacian culture. Actually, we can see that scrapers are a big deal for Perrot in that time. In all three assemblages, scrapers getting a very center place in the publication. Nevertheless, we can see, we can appreciate that those, the El Kusser D assemblage and Mazar Kenash, we can see already more blades and bladelets features in these ones. Another find in this scale is the split base point, as was published in 1955. This is the drawing from the publication. This is the actual bone points, split base point, which is interesting because this tool type, the split base point, is a tight tool for the European Aurignacian industry. If I'm not mistaken, to the middle phase, but the Aurignacian here in the crowd will correct me if I'm wrong. Interestingly enough, that in this publication it was stressed that it was found in layer D, which supposedly is not Aurignacian, but this is something that we'll have to deal with in the near future. Okay, so a little bit about the voyage of the trip of the material since it was excavated until it got to our hand, to re-analysis that we do. So first, of course, the material was excavated in these two sites and was brought to Bethlehem via donkeys. Afterwards, the material passed to Peru, as mentioned above. After it was published, the third step, he got stored in the CRFG facility in Amaus. Only then, just before Peru is left Israel, he's passing the material to the University of Tel Aviv. And the final stage, when we get in the picture, the material is got to Ben Gurion University through the hands of Ofer Marden. Okay, this is a table, the results of the typological analysis that we did for the material from El Kusser. Only for a brief look, we can see that there is something a bit uneven in the two columns. While in layer C, there is not at all debris. The debris are totally absent, and the tools are very, very high in percentage, more than the two-thirds even, or about two-thirds of the assemblage, while the assemblage of layer D is acting differently. Although debris are rare, they do exist. Most of the large part of the assemblage is the debitage, the wasters, which are controlled by blades and bladelets. Affinity for the Achmarian culture, as Gilad defined it in 81. And around 10% of tools. How could we explain this partial nature of layer C? We might see in a footnote that Perrault written in 55, which basically say that the large items, probably the heavier items, were abandoned by the excavator on the way to Bethlehem, which a route that took more than one day. So this could explain the partial nature of layer C. Okay, those are three tables of the material that we have in the lab and start processing. From a short look, we can see that in El Kusser, some of the artifacts are covered in a red residue, possibly ochre. In layer C, the scrapers are very characteristic, some of them carinated. Some of them carinated on a Mousterian point, a phenomenon that we see in Aurignacian industry, and also Aurignacian blades. You'll have to trust me that the retouch on these blades are very invasive, which is a feature of the Achmarian, of the Aurignacian, sorry, industry. Layer D also have scrapers, but more blade and bladelet in nature, accompanied by Elwad points, which is the type tool of the Achmarian industry. And what layer D also is offering us is refitted sequences, which could be attested to a different method of collection or keeping the material that we see between layer C, which is partial, and layer D that is as complete as that we can. After all that time and all these steps of the material that he went through, that we actually have items that we can refit. And these are not the only refit sequences that we have. We have more than that. In Mazra Kenaj, we can already feel the microlithization process, as mentioned in the research, as Nigel is described the Mazrakan culture, retouched and semi-abrupt bladelets, some of them twisted, are the most significant, let's say, in the toolkit of this assemblage. I didn't say before, the typological analysis of Masrek and Nash assemblage is on, in process. Because of that, the table wasn't showed, because it's not finished yet. Burins accompanied the bladed tool and scrapers. 5 minutes. Okay, so why these two sites are important? Ecoser and Masrek and Nash contain remains of human occupation during the early and final stages of the Upper Paleolithic, and therefore offering us a cultural and technological windows, let's say, to these phases within the Upper Paleolithic. The stratigraphic El Kusser is important by itself because it contains stratigraphic sequence which contain Levantine Orientation overlying the Akhmarian layer. The fact that El Kusser has an Akhmarian layer is often overlooked in the recent publication of the Upper Paleolithic, so we aiming to deal with this problem, let's say. And Masrek and Nash is important, of course, because it's considered a type site to the Masrekan culture in the final stages of the Upper Paleolithic. So now a little bit about our work in trying to finding the sites. In this picture is emphasizing the difficulties that we are encountering in the field. The streams of the Judean desert often have a lot of small rock shelters, caves, and this trial to find the sites could be considered as trying to find the needle in a haystack. So, what are we looking for? What will tell us that we might be in the correct site? So we are looking for a cave or a rock shelter, because this is what Perot is saying in the article. We're looking for a large and regular, most probably rectangular excavation pit, because we need to remember that the Arabs, which was the excavator of the sites of Neville at the past and of those two sites, was trained archaeologists. So this is what we are looking to find in these sites. We need to find past excavation dump and lithic industry, which is suitable to what Perot published in 55 and what we see in the lab. So these four marks made us to conclude that we actually found the correct place of El Kusser site, which is actually a small cave with two chambers, with a large rectangular pit, with at least three still standing straight section, one of them about a meter deep. In other section we have maybe a remnant of a hut, and a lithic industry which fits generally to Perot's description. I can say that we also found an Elwad point, but unfortunately we didn't took a photo of it for this presentation, so you'll have to take my word for it. Also the dump, past excavation dump at the entrance of the site. This is the excavation is here. So the location of the site. The location of the site by Perot is incorrect, but not as far incorrect. Let's say is 800 meters to the southeast of the published location. The location is here. How we can explain that is we can assume that the Ta'amra man, when he told them about the site, he used a non-topographic for the local non-topographic traits. So we said, yeah, the site is near El Kusser. El Kusser is located here and is actually a ruins of Byzantine chapels. So this name is known in the area. And the other name, Masrek and Nash, is actually a topographic point on the bank of Nachal Darga, the Daraja. So one site we found. Now we're going to Masrek and Nash. This is Masrek and Nash in Hebrew. When we looked for the meaning of the name in Arabic, we got to the meaning of elusive thief. And actually this site is elusive indeed. We are still looking for it. We are covered the upper Daraja stream with its tributaries, even as a small stream that's going all the way up to Masrek and Nash. The points UD, upper Daraja 2, 5, those are caves which do not contain all the marker all the marks that we are looking for. So those are some of them. Some of the sites does have excavation pits pretty small compared to the one in El Cusser, but do not contain a suitable lithic industry. Some of them contain only lithic industry and do not contain past excavation pit. Some of them was cleaned totally, but we didn't see a suitable lithic industry. And some of them are just nice caves with no archaeology or excavation. So a short summary for our project till now. Our attempt to relocate the site based on the oral information published by Perrault in 55 revealed that the description of the chief of excavation was essentially reliable. Because 800 meters away is pretty reliable, and also the section and the differentiating between the different layers. This enabled us to refine the chronocultural framework of the Upper Paleolithic in the southern Levant, as Perrault did and as Gilad did in 81. Our future plan, as mentioned before, is to publish the material and to deal with the technological aspect as well as chronocultural implication of the material from El Cusser and Mazar Kenash. Archival research might help us to find new perspective on the excavation of El Cusser and Mazar Kenash. Maybe we will find something that will lead us more correctly or more directly to Mazar Kenash. And the trial for finding Mazar Kenash is an ongoing process, and we keep going to the field basically until we find the site. I'm finishing, sorry. This is why I'm afraid of a microphone, because you can... Okay, so I have to thank especially to Boaz Langford, Roy Galili, and Eliyahu Cohen Sasson, which regularly join us to the surveys and the continuing essays to find the site. Thank you.